I'm Ronaldo Marcus Green, and I'm director of Top Boy Block 1, episodes 1, 2, and 3.
Hello, I'm Dion Edwards, and I worked on the project Top Boy. I was Ray's mentee and got to do a little bit of second unit on it as well. Well, yeah, I watched it a while back, and like everyone else, I think most people sort of my age were huge fans of it. It was, I remember when it was coming out on Channel 4, and for me, it was just the fact that it was set in Hackney, which is where I'm from, East London, and just the way it kind of really tried to kind of represent reality. I just thought it was a great miniseries, and so I was really into it.
The first time I saw Top Boy, I don't know, maybe 2014, 15, and it's not a US show, but I had seen it somehow. I messaged the actors from the film, hey, my name is Ronaldo Marcus Green, and I'm an aspiring filmmaker at NYU, and just wanted to let you know I saw you in this series, and I'm casting my first feature. You know, maybe one day we'll get a chance to work together. Nobody replied except for Sean Romulus, who plays Driss. It's funny, fast forward 5 years later, I'm now directing these guys in the series, and I showed them the Facebook inbox message, and it was just, you know, so fortunate to have come, you know, come here to help help bring the story out. Here in London, I think it's such a cultural thing, and it was so specific here. And so, you know, when I saw it, I was like, oh, I had never felt a show that I had connected with outside of The Wire that felt like this real, that felt like, oh, okay, this is an experience that is very close to home for me. And of course, I talk to my friends, people of color in the States, and they all know about it, but it's definitely was more cult. And I think, you know, the fact that now it's a Netflix series and a lot more episodes, a lot more people behind it, I think a lot more people are going to become aware of the series. I actually came to London pitching a feature idea. I wanted to do something about Grenfell Tower. I had a round of producer meetings on one day. I was here for 24 hours, and I still happened to meet Charles and Ali, who are the producers of the show. They had seen my film Monsters and Men at Sundance, and so we just got to talking. I told them I was a huge fan of the show. I had seen it 5 years before, and they had just seen my movie, so there was a lot of crossover there. Drake was also an executive producer on my first feature, Monsters and Men. He's an EP on this show, and they said to me at the time that they were already out to another director, a U.S. director at the time, and I said, listen, if things don't work out, give me a call, let me know. And 2 weeks later, I got a phone call saying that director had dropped out, and if I'd be interested, they sent me the scripts, and, you know, pitching to Netflix in LA 2 days later, and then I was out here in March, so it went pretty quick.
I came on board quite late into the process. Yvonne Ibazibo, the series producer, got in touch and said that Netflix wanted to put together a kind of mentorship scheme, because I guess they kind of felt that in the UK there weren't sort of as big a crop of kind of directors who had made their first feature or who had enough TV experience. So Yvonne asked me to do it. I said yes. And I'd seen Ray's short, which I really loved as well. So I was just really excited to get involved.
I think Netflix gives you the freedom. You hear it all the time. You know, you got 10 hours of television that you can go. But what was so great about this marriage is that it was a UK series originally. And I think Charles and Ali maintained the rights to the project as well. So it was really their show. And Netflix just came in with the resources to help them make their show rather than sort of take it over. From a creative standpoint, from my standpoint, you know, obviously I was hired to do the job, but I felt like we had 100% total creative freedom.
The main thing that was exciting to me is just how the kind of scope of it, the fact that we now have 10 episodes, because it was, you know, only 4 last time, which was great, but this sort of gives it the chance to kind of do something. I'm not comparing it to The Wire, but The Wire is amazing because it kind of really gets to, you know, play out a story across hours and hours and hours. So just the fact that Netflix took it on kind of gave it the opportunity to make the story really big, which is really exciting.
I think a lot of the fundamentals remain the same. Des Hamilton, who had cast series 1 and 2, is still the casting director on series 3. And Des is a master at helping to find young talent. He's from a certain area. He understands the community. So that was huge having him come back on board. Letitia Wright is in series 1, and, you know, now she's a global superstar. So we were trying to do the same thing here. You know, Michael Ward, who now plays the character of Jamie, came in to read for Aaron. It was a little itty bitty part, and I remember sitting in the audition with Yvonne and saying, I think this kid's a star. He needs to come back and read for the main role. So, you know, I think it's a discovery type show. I think Ronan's done an incredible job, you know, tackling, you know, global issues, especially things that are important in London, whether it's Brexit or immigration. There's so many issues that are being tackled, but I don't think it's heavy-handed, whether it's Deschain walking by a boarded-up house. You know, we don't say much about it, but that's it says so much. It speaks volumes. It's important to tackle these things because London has changed.
They kind of stuck to what made the first two seasons great, which was the kind of realism. At the same time, I think the key to it is really great characters. I think all the new faces in it, for starters, the youngers in it, they're kind of really relatable to young people, but actually you still have the older generation as well. The characters are really rounded. They're not just, you know, people kind of sharpening their knives. They actually have, they're kind of, you know, you see their humanity in this series and you see kind of the reasons why they're doing what they do. And I think that makes it universal.
I don't know if it was one particular moment. We were working with small children, kids, and who had never acted before. So, you know, funny story with one of the youngers that they were looking at the camera, you know, the entire time. And I was like, oh my God, I got to get through my day. And I got a kid that's just staring at the lens. And literally the DP had to, put a piece of red tape around the lens and said, don't look here, just to get the kids to stop looking at the lens. So it's always tricky working with non-actors, but what you get are, you know, what you get are some really raw and fun and some gems that happen. You just gotta run the camera a little bit longer.
For me, it's like seeing, obviously this is all shot in real locations, and that was a lot for me to kind of learn about and shot on estates, and you see how small some of these rooms are, and it was just amazing what these guys were doing, like Ray kind of working out where to put the camera, and, you know, we have a whole crew kind of stuffed into one corner, so I could just see the challenges of that every single day, but what it does is kind of give you a real kind of, yeah, sense of realism. For me, what was exciting about kind of working with Ray in this is that he's the block one director of the series, so he's kind of essentially setting the whole vision for the entire thing. So that prep period was the most interesting for me, to see how he'd kind of thought out the series and kind of thought out the characters and the story and how he was going to put it together visually.
And they always say, write what you know, right? They always say, and I think Top Boy was in my wheelhouse of things that I didn't feel like I had to go very far to find myself in it. Yes, I'm not from London, but I didn't have to feel like I had to make up the experience. I knew kids that had been stabbed. I knew kids that had been shot. I knew kids that have gone to jail in my high school and middle school. So these were things that were happening to me in my community in the Bronx and in Brooklyn, you know, and that just transfer here. So when I got the opportunity to do Top Boy, it felt like, man, this is something that directly aligns with what it is that who I am and the kinds of things that I want to represent. It's the humanity in Top Boy that I respond to. I don't think this show for me is about let's glorify drug culture or gangs. That's not what this show is about. The show, of course, these are the things that happen circumstantially because this is the world that we're in. But it's about the young kids who have a chance to see this and say, you know what, I don't have to do that, or I can take a different road. And so I think for me, it's important to obviously tell stories that mean something to you, to work in a world that you find that is important, so that you can bring something to the show, you know, whatever it is, the medium that you're working in, that you can bring something and illuminate something in that.
I'd say in terms of advice for directors, I think you can sometimes worry that you have to do so much and you have to kind of make so many decisions and wear so many hats. But it's just kind of getting to the essentials of it and remembering that as a director, you're kind of the keeper of the story and you just have to know the story inside out. And all you have to do really is kind of inspire the team around you. Yeah, think about the story rather than, you know, the lenses and all that stuff. Obviously, it's something that you need to think about as director, but when it comes down to it, it's about you knowing the story more than anyone else and, yeah, being able to communicate that vision.
All the stories in Top Boy are based in some reality. So there's nothing that's made up, whether it's, you know, the scene at the hospital where the kids get, you know, they get stabbed on the street and then they follow the same gang to the hospital and they get into the same fight. Like, this is all based on real stories. So you don't have to look very far. You just open up the newspaper and there's every day you hear a stabbing, you hear, you know, what you don't see is the lives of the brothers and the families that are affected behind them, or why we're in these situations. So we just say, oh, that's a gangster. He has no problem, you know, and you sort of point the finger at, like, look at these kids, look at them. We're not saying it's okay to go out and do these things, but where did they get the knives? Where did they get the drugs? Where are they coming from? We don't do enough introspection to say, how do these communities kind of form? When gentrification happens, what happens to the people within these communities? Whether it's education. So these are the things that you hope the show illuminates.
It's just about kind of exploring humanity, and that's what we get to do in film and TV, and I think that's what this story is doing really well. And I think that's what you've done an amazing job with in directing it.